cross of my Lord Jesus Christ, and to the faith for which it stands, one Savior, eternal, with mercy and grace for all. So help me God.
We begin our worship for this 4th of July event in the name of God the Father. God the Son,
who made the Christ at Calvary's cross, so that he might have true freedom through the forgiveness of all our sins and new life. Amen.
And in the name of God the Holy Spirit,
who has first saved the image of Christ in our hearts through the means of grace, the gospel, and sacraments. Amen.
As we continue on page 3, let us now confess our sins before God and before one another, asking our gracious God to forgive us for the sake of the blood that our Lord Jesus shed for us. Almighty God,
maker of all things and judge of all people, we admit and confess our sins. We have turned away from each other in our deeds, speaking, and doing good. We have done the evil you forbid, and God done the good to the man. We do repent and are truly sorry for all our sins. Therefore, have mercy on us and forgive us. Lead us into a greater understanding of your will as we seek to love our neighbor. Guide us by your Spirit so that we may faithfully serve you and your church through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
God has promised forgiveness of sins to those who repent and turn to Him. Therefore, it is my privilege as God's servant to proclaim to you that all your sins are forgiven. May God keep you in His grace, and by His Spirit, keep you in the one true faith. Finally, may He bring you to live with Him forever, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Please be seated as we continue with the reading.
Your Old Testament reading is from Zechariah, and this is great. He gives us what's going to happen after he listed in Zechariah all the enemies of Israel that he was going to crush. And so this is what's going to happen after he crushes all these enemies. Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout aloud, O daughter of Jerusalem. Behold, your king is coming to you, righteous, having salvation, as he is he. Humble, mounted on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey. I'm sorry, young lady, I didn't watch you do that. The foal of a donkey. I will cut off the chariot of Ephraim and the war horse of Jerusalem. In the battle, foe shall be cut off, and he shall speak peace to the nations. His rule shall be from sea to sea, and the river to the ends of the earth. As for you also, because of the blood of my covenant with you, I will set your prisoners free from the waterless pit. Return to your stronghold, O prisoners of hope. Today I declare that I will restore to you covenant. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The epistle comes from Romans. We hear Paul really tell us what we are. And it's interesting to realize that in God's world, nothing has changed. He created it over 6,000 years ago, and nothing's really changed. In the human race, we are good or bad, we're good again. It goes generation after generation after generation. Our really great friend Paul really throws it out here. We know that the law is a spiritual, but I am of the flesh, so under sin. I do not understand my own actions, for I do not do what I want, but I do the very thing I hate. Now, if I do what I do not want, I agree with the law that it is good. So now it is no longer I who do it, but sin that dwells within me. For I know that nothing good dwells in me, that is, in my flesh. For I have the desire to do what is right, but not the ability to carry it out. For I do not do the good I want, but the evil I do not want is what I keep on doing. Now if I do what I do not want, it is no longer I who do it, but sin that dwells within me. So I find it to be a law that when I do want to do right, evil lies close at hand. For I delight in the law of God in my inner being, but I see my members, another law waging war against the law of my mind, and make me captive of the law of sin that dwells in my members. Wretched man that I am, who will deliver me from this body of death? Thanks be to God through Jesus Christ our Lord. This is the word of the Lord. Please stand for the Gospel of Matthew. There is a word in here I want you to really listen to. Because this is a passage that declares God's grace, God's forgiveness. And that tells us how life is loaded. Okay? But there's a word in here close to the end that I really want you to think about. Okay, here we go. Matthew 11. At the time, Jesus declared, I thank you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, that you have hidden these things from the wise and understanding and revealed them to little children. Yes, Father, for such was your gracious will. All things have been handed over to me by my Father. And I know one knows the Son except the Father, and no one knows the Father except the Son, and anyone to whom the Son chooses to reveal to him. Come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Here ends the word of the Lord.
God, the Father, before all worlds, God, the God, by
come together, as we have for years and years and years. We always pick a Sunday closest to 4th of July to celebrate our national heritage, to celebrate our freedoms as Americans. So, we decided, lately we've been doing this the last Sunday of June, but that seemed to be a bit far away. Yesterday was the 4th of July, but if you're like me, if you drove around town a little bit, you couldn't tell it. Now, there was a handful of people, realizing for our internet audience, Oklahoma City bans fireworks, yet somehow that doesn't seem to stop some of our neighbors from having a little joy. Mary and I had lunch yesterday, and as we left the restaurant, the waitress said, "Enjoy the fireworks," and I started to say, "Where?" Hello. Well, we're in the pandemic 4th of July, and it is sad. But, as always, we come to the word of the Lord. Romans reminds us we are sinful. St. Paul himself is saying, "I'm sinful, and I don't do what God would have me do all the time," and that's all of us. And so, we also have the words of Jesus from the gospel. Strong and important words. Give your burdens to God, and He will care for us. Before both of those, we have what for us as a liturgical church is Palm Sunday Old Testament reading once every 3 years from Zechariah 9. And frankly, it is the sermon text for the testimony preaching on Zechariah at the beginning of July rather than on Palm Sunday, which would be March or April for us normally. But Zechariah realizing what's going on with Zechariah. You know, as I've said in our newsletters and from this moment before, sometimes we get depressed, sometimes we begin to feel sorry for ourselves and say, "Oh, woe is us," you know, and indeed, for our graduates and for the people who play sport, I mean, we have total disruption. But yet, even for all the inconveniences, and yes, getting the virus and dying is a huge inconvenience, nobody wants that. Yet, go back and look at the history, which, by the way, is my theory. Why is our nation having so much difficulties with protests and stuff over these last month? Was nobody studies history, nobody reads history. Okay? And so, the same with the virus. Go back to 1918. My grandfather suiting up the U.S. Army to go to France to fight the war. And the doctor's telling the military, "If you put all those guys on a ship, you're going to have, because the Spanish flu was throughout the world. Europe lost 30 million with an M people, the Spanish flu. We in the USA lost, I think, 750,000 people, realizing our population was way less than it is now. I don't know what that percentage was in 1918, but 750,000 deaths. And of course, part of that was medical knowledge and drugs and hospital care. Just didn't happen. It was interesting, though, that President Wilson, because of World War I, said, "We're going to celebrate the 4th of July because we need to ramp up the war effort." And he encouraged cities throughout America to hold 4th of July services and celebrations. There's a picture on PBS showing the giant parade in Washington, D.C. on 4th of July in 1918. And there are hundreds of thousands of people there. No, they weren't wearing masks. The guy talking about it, the historian, said, "We have a clue how many people died because of 4th of July in 1918. So again, lest we get too down, our generations before us have seen more. As I told you in the July newsletter, I think back, and I got a big sorrow for myself, I think, of my grandparents. who lived through two world wars, a depression, and a dust bowl here in Oklahoma. Parents, one world war, and other challenges. So yes, it is a challenge, and yes, we're inconvenienced, and yes, this thing can kill some people. Maybe not all people, right? It's not killing all people, but how do you know if you're the one unless you've got it? And yet, we come back. On this 4th of July service, I have a strange thing. And it's, behold your king. And it's like, wait a minute, Pastor, it's 4th of July. Wasn't the whole purpose of 4th of July was to get rid of the king? King George of England. When the American colonies gathered together in Philadelphia. And oh, by the way, the resolution to pass to accept the Declaration of Independence, one vote. There's been a movie about that, and I have no idea, because who knows what Hollywood knows about history and Joe very little. But according to them, one guy was going to vote no, and Ben Franklin said, stay home sick tomorrow. Otherwise, it would have been a tie. We'd have no declaration. That was the way it goes. But years, centuries before the birth of Jesus Christ, God's people, the Israelites, were carried off into captivity. They lost the northern kingdom in 722 B.C. and by the Assyrians, and wiped that country out. And the southern kingdom of Judea, was overrun in 586 B.C. And those people were carried off into Babylon, and that's where they were at when Zechariah wrote his words. He talked about being prisoners of hope. Their city was destroyed. The temple was leveled. And they were carted out. Well, the people, I've told you this before, the people that could do stuff, you know, the carpenters and people who could work and were useful to society, I use that term, they were carted off to Babylon. But if you were sick or elderly or disabled, they just left you there to die. And so carted them off to Babylon. That's the people listening. First words, first audience is actually he's writing to. That your king will come, and of course, we know the connection because Matthew and John both connect this passage to Jesus riding to Jerusalem on that Palm Sunday. That your king is coming. You had last week talking about Jesus will bring not peace but a sword, and from a Christian standpoint, it's I know Ron's preached about that, but it's like, wait a minute. He's the Prince of Peace. Yes, he brought peace to the earth, but the peace between us who are sinful and fallen and God, our Heavenly Father. That's the peace. Because ever since the crucifixion and resurrection of Jesus Christ, has there been world peace? No. Why? Because sin and Satan are always there. As I said in the newsletter, and I said a couple weeks ago, why is there unrest in America? Because of sin and Satan. Why is there racism? Because of sin and Satan. It's always going to be there. There is no perfect world this side of heaven. But also, having said that, there's no politician, there's no law that will change any of that for Americans. It's only God and the Spirit will change the hearts and minds. Having said that, we as Christians know that we've got neighbors and family. When we talk to them about Jesus Christ, God's Son, that He came to the world to save the world. There's a reason, John 3:16, Jesus died for whom? For all the world, for all people. Black, white, yellow, or brown, rich, or poor, it does not matter. Jesus died for all. So, as we celebrate our freedoms this year. Perhaps, just perhaps, it's a little more important to us because we did something that to me was unthinkable when wants you to be. No church? No church since March 22nd, all the way to May 10th. No church. I had a great appreciation for us in Oklahoma as we traveled to Portland last week to visit Mary's daughter. And Portland still plays one. And Mary's daughter's church just opened. And then having said that, I think they had to have three or four different services because they were limited to 25 or 50 people. I can't remember the limit, but they were like here and here. Because that's the world we're in, and it is a challenge, and it is a struggle. But in the midst of it all, we have God's sure and definite promise. I will be with you. You will survive. You will endure. Verse 9 is the messianic verse in our text. The king is coming, and indeed the king did come. Remember, going back to Matthew 2, the birth of Jesus Christ, and the wise men coming to Herod to say, hey, we're looking for the king. Well, Herod was the king. And so, you're looking for the king. Tell me where he's at so I can worship him. Yeah, right. Well, did Herod want to know where that baby was so he could kill him? When the wise men didn't come back, Herod was so angry, he sent troops into Bethlehem and slaughtered every male child to and under. Because that's what sin is supposed to do. He shall speak peace to the nations and rule from sea to sea to the ends of the earth. That's the word of God. That's Jesus Christ. God created the heavens and the earth. It's there. I long said, wait a minute. Look at the plethora of life along our planet. We were blessed last week to walk on the shores of the Pacific Ocean and you watch those thundering waves come in and you say, well, this just didn't happen. Or you go to the mountains or the plains of the Midwest. God created heavens and the earth. But ultimately, as Zechariah told the people who were in captivity, we too are prisoners of hope. We are challenged, as Paul reminds us, by our own sinfulness and by our disability to follow God's words. The prisoners from Zechariah's day were captive literally and physically in Babylon. But the prisoners of hope through faith. We also know there's those within the world that if you're a Christian in certain areas of this world, they will take you out and shoot you, or they'll lock you up, or they'll take away your Bible. We've had generation after generation for over 240 years of Americans, men and women, dying. Watched for about the 100th time the movie Pearl Harbor yesterday. Just very like, well, you've seen this. Yeah, but it makes you remember. Also, by the way, wore my Pearl Harbor shirt yesterday, which has all the ships sunk on that day. And that's because that generation is almost gone. There's very few of them left. In 2012, when we were at Pearl Harbor, there was just a handful of guys, and I think the youngest guy there was like 90. So, we also remember on this day those who sacrificed so we could be here, so we could worship Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. We remember them. And we have the words of God who speaks to us yet today. And our hope for our nation, to trust in God. Let it be more than just slogan on our money. Trust in the Lord thy God and you'll be saved. Believe in Jesus Christ. Come together as the people of God and as a nation. But ultimately on this 4th of July service, we are reminded of those who made the ultimate sacrifice so we can be here. And that's thousands upon thousands of men and women. But we also know that the thousands, for many of those wars, were prisoners of war. Like we lost Senator McCain here just a few years ago, prisoner of Vietnam. But we also know of the great suffering and the trauma and the pain, the suffering of our nation right now as we go through yet another trial and tribulation. But yet, we are reminded of the great sacrifice of those who gave us our freedoms. We are reminded also of the passion, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ, God's own Son, who died on the cross for our sins and for the sins of all mankind. So this day, we thank God for our nation that we live here. Been blessed to be in a number of countries. And I've yet to go to a country to say, when I came home, boy, I would rather live there than in the United States of America because I don't think that country exists. And yet, dear friends, a nation without God is no nation at all. And may we as Christians continue to share the gospel message with all our friends and neighbors and all whom we encounter so that God may bless this nation and bless our work by extension and bless our nation now and into the future. Amen. Now may that peace of God, which does transcend all human understanding, keep your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus this day and every day. Let us pray. Almighty God, you have given us this good land as our heritage. Grant that we remember your generosity and constantly do your will. Bless our land with honest industry, truthful education, and an honorable way of life. And save us from violence, discord, and confusion, from pride and arrogance, and from every evil course of action. Bring us who came from many nations with many different languages, a united nation, under God. Defend our liberties and give those whom we have entrusted with the authority of government the spirit of wisdom, that there may be justice and peace in our land. And when times are prosperous, let our hearts be thankful. And in troubled times, do not let our trust in you fail. Lord, in your mercy. Lord God, you are the source of strength. We praise you for the assurance of your presence. Lord, in your mercy. Dear God, Heavenly Father, we recognize that all the evil, all the hate, all the strife is caused by our own sinfulness and by the great deceiver, Satan. We pray a mighty outpouring of your Spirit upon our nation, upon our state, and upon our city. For it is only through your power that we can be healed as a nation. Bring all people together under the cross of Christ, Jesus, and block out the temptations of the evil one who seeks only to destroy and devour us. And grant us your holy protection to all citizens, but especially those Christians who seek to do your will. Be with us now and in the future as we pray for your guidance and your wisdom in all things. Lord, in your mercy. Father, we pray this day for all our congregational officers, leaders, and members, that you will continue to bless us with mutual love, harmony, and unity. Guide us by the power of your Holy Spirit so that all we do and say will be in your praise, glory, and honor. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, upon stretch forth your almighty arm to strengthen and protect all the men and women who serve in the armed forces of our nation throughout the world, especially on this 4th of July weekend. But especially be with those who are serving in the most dangerous areas of the world. Support them as they go about their mission and keep them from all evil, giving them courage and loyalty, and granting that in all things they may serve honestly and without reproach. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, we lay before your throne of grace the needs of your people. We pray for all those who are sick and shut in, and those known to you, but especially that we pray this day for Ivan Smith, for Yolinda Smith, for Lucille Turner, for Maya, for Lon Keister, for Harvey Norris, for Anna Warnke, for Paula Montgomery, for Sandy Osmus, for Stephanie Ruth, for Reverend Lewis Kennedy, for Barbara Phillips, for Melinda Dory, for Jim Adams, for Kimberly McKay, for William Jackson. We pray your spirit's comfort to be upon each of them, O Lord, that you would guard and protect them in the days and weeks ahead, and that if it be thy will, you would grant healing to the sick and comfort to the afflicted. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And Heavenly Father, we pray a prayer of joy this day at the birth of Emma Catherine Hewlings, born yesterday on July 4th. The grandparents are Lois and Marcus. Be with mother and child in the days and weeks ahead. Keep both safe and allow Emma to grow and prosper as a child of God. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. Lord, in your mercy, as we pray together, our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
The Lord Jesus Christ, on the night he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, take eat, this is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me. And in the same way, he took the cup after supper. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, drink of it, all of you, for this is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. But do as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Thank you.
This eating and drinking of the true body and blood of your Lord and Savior strengthen and preserve you steadfast into true faith to life everlasting. Go in His peace and continue to serve the Lord in gladness. Amen. Let us pray. We give thanks to you, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us through this salutary gift. And we implore you that of your mercy, you would strengthen us through the same in faith. Toward you in a fervent love toward one another. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Now, dear friends in Christ, as you go forth this day and every day, may the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious unto you. The Lord always look upon you with favor and give you his peace.